We go. All right, we're recording. And once again, I just want to welcome everybody to our webinar tonight. We are talking about wonderful music programs without big pockets. So we're looking at strategies about how to have vibrant music programs when the money that we all wish would be available for them isn't always there. A few things before we begin, I want to, with gratitude, say that this collaborative discussion, this webinar, is sponsored by Soul Matters, which is a congregational resource group. And then also, formerly known as the UUMN, the UU Minister or Musicians Network, now is the AUUMN, the Association of UU Music Ministries. And tonight we have LB, who is Lyle Brown, but we all call him LB, who is on the executive committee, right, LB?
Yes, I'm the treasurer of AUUMM.
That's great. And LB also serves as the music director for UU Lansing in Michigan. And LB, in a second, I'll just be quiet, and LB is going to be facilitating our discussion. And he's going to be doing that along with Sarah Jo Brandt, who, if you look over, Sarah, can you wave for us? There we go. So Sarah Jo and LB will be leading the discussion tonight. Sarah Jo wonderfully has given her gifts to be the music director of Soul Matters, but she's also the music director in the First UU Church in Syracuse, New York. So just huge thanks to LB and Sarah for guiding us tonight, and also the way they represent the UU or the AUUMN, who's also here in spirit. Real quick, I want to say that this is the first of two meetings. We're going to hold another webinar on Thursday, which is, I was going to say a repeat of this, but not quite, right? It'll be a different discussion. So you're invited to come back again. It'll be a whole different discussion. So you can come back on Thursday and I'm sure experience some other gems. But if you're not able to be here on Thursday, or if you have colleagues or other lay leaders or professional leaders who you think would be interested in this discussion, we will be recording both of these calls and making them available both through the AUUMN and also through Soul Matters. And we'll share more information about that. But you'll have these as recordings. And I think that's really all about logistical stuff. Before I turn it over to LB and Sergio, though, let me just say I'm a parish minister, and I just wanted to say how much gratitude I have for tonight's discussion. Every music colleague that I've ever worked with, and I think this goes for all folks, lay, professional, who are working in the music ministry, have really understood their work, not just as picking out music, and not just as a music ministry, but also as a healing ministry. So in my experience, when I've worked with musicians and we've been at our best and the partnership's been the strongest, I have felt great gratitude for the way in which the music ministry has helped me produce a healing ministry at the church. And also as a minister, it's a little secret. I'm a little embarrassed because this will be recorded and made public, but I need to confess that I have never given better than a B+ sermon in my life. And yet, because of the music colleagues and volunteers and choirs and soloists around me, congregations think I've given numerous A sermons and A+ sermons because the music has always made me better. And so just out of that gratitude for making me better as a preacher and also for being a partner in healing ministry, I hope tonight is a small way of giving back to all the folks who participate in music ministry and give so many gifts to preachers like me. And so with that, LB and Sergio, let me turn it over to you.
So when we were talking, Scott and LB and I, we kind of came up with three questions that we thought people would really want to discuss. Plus another quick introduction of one other thing. So tonight we want to spend like maybe 5 minutes just discussing some real technical things like percentages of budgets that are recommended and what people are actually getting. And many of you probably don't know that off the top of your head. I know I don't carry my budget numbers around with me in my head. I always have to ask my bookkeeper and my treasurer and look very sheepish when I do it. But we're going to just spend a couple minutes with that, and then we're going to discuss how to actually do things, how to actually get things done. And if there's time at the end, we'll go back to the budget and fundraising and discuss how to grow that. But we kind of thought it would be more important just to talk about how what can we do, brainstorm some ideas, what's worked for congregations, what hasn't. Yeah, so the UUMN, because it was before, right? 13 years ago or something, came up with a brochure in which it was recommended that the music program, including staff compensation and professional development and all the things that you need, should be approximately 7 to 10% of your congregation's budget. That assumes that your congregation has a budget. I know there are some that are just operating out of people's houses, and that's great, but you probably don't have much of a budget if you're one of those, right? And we kind of thought it would be interesting to see what people are actually making, or not making, but what the programs are actually getting for a percentage. And so I asked on the AUUMM group, that's going to be a group of people whose congregations are already supporting music, well enough that they've been able to join the AUUMM, correct? So they might be higher numbers than what other people have, but one of the larger churches is at about 8.5%. Couple actually are in the eights. One is, one that should be higher is 6.2. Well, most everybody is around 8%, which is kind of nice. And I will say, I looked at mine, over the past couple of years, and mine has actually increased because I've been advocating really loudly, from 4% up to, I had 8.4%, and this year we added one staff person, so that took me back down a little bit. So it is possible to grow, even if you're not at that level now. The first question, we came up with three things to talk about. How do you get music? How do you get instruments? And how do you get musicians? For some congregations, a musician will be a regular every Sunday or every service musician, and some are going to be discussing how to get special musicians in. But we thought we would give each question about 10 minutes. And I'm going to be kind of the timekeeper. And so I'll give you a warning, unless we're having a really great discussion, which I hope we do, but I'll give you a warning when we get close to the 10-minute mark so that we can keep track of time and we don't end up here all night, which would be wonderful. But we all have other places to be as well. So brilliant ideas for where to get music when you can't afford to purchase any. Legal. We'd like to suggest legal ways to follow copyright rules.
So my role in this discussion is to facilitate each discussion for each question and make sure that people get heard from who want to be heard from, and that we keep the conversation going. I know many of us who came to the call tonight are looking more for answers, but I think if you look within, you will find that you actually have some strategies that you're using that other people may not know about. I'll present a couple right off the bat. And my role is as director of music, but specifically I'm also the choir director for the adult mixed choir. So that's where most of my knowledge comes from. But I know some of you are looking at simply piano music. Some of you are looking for bands and things like that. So we'll need for you to contribute what you can from those areas. In addition to the regular purchase from a music distributor for choir music, I found that most of them, if you are diligent in your work with them, will offer sales, significant sales. And thank you. I know Chandler Music in Arizona has a 30% sale. You get a 30% discount for pieces that you buy in quantity if you order within a certain time, and that's usually June the month of June. This year, they also did one in December. So it, for me, it helped a lot. We're in an interim position and services are changing a lot. So I wasn't able to buy for the entire year last year, but I could put my order in December, get it in January, and have it be 30% less than what it normally would be. And other distributors do the same thing. I know University Music in, I believe it's Delaware, has a significant discount sale. And so check with your own distributor that you usually order from if you are ordering music in quantity and see when the best time to order from them would be. Can somebody speak further to that point of working with your distributors?
LB, I have a thought. Well, Mark, why don't you go first? Because mine's not speaking directly to it, but I had a question. So Mark, go ahead.
Well, mine's not speaking directly to it, but I just wanted to mention that Jason Shelton's Cycle of Song is an 8-piece set that's available digitally. You buy the PDF and he asks for payment based on the number of people in your choir. So it's per piece. It's quite a bit less than buying sheet music. Now, you have to substitute your own labor and copying and printing and assembly time. But in terms of a cost to purchase per piece of music, that was a great buy, and it's great music.
Wonderful. That's a good resource. And I had been aware of it, and it got pushed to the back. So I am taking note of that and adding it to my own.
So I know of a number of congregations using that right now that have had good success. And I started looking at it at the last conference and I got distracted by, I don't know, squirrels or something. So I haven't gotten back to it yet.
So LB and Sarah Jo, I'd like maybe you to comment on this, but LB, as you were talking, it occurs to me that one of the benefits of theme-based ministry and particularly Soul Matters is that we are now a sort of a web of congregations all on the same themes. So it occurs to me, and we also hold, Sarah runs music brainstorming meetings well in advance, 2 to 3 months in advance of all meetings. Long-winded way of saying, I'm wondering if these sales, if sometimes there's a sale, if you buy a certain amount, do you get a better deal if you buy more? So if Soul Matters congregations went in together, like a bunch of congregations went in together, could they get a better deal somehow?
That's possible. That would be ordering in huge quantities, and I'm not familiar with that, but I would think that we could talk our distributors into that, but it would have to then be reshipped from somewhere else.
So I just want to throw that out, that if anybody has ever stumbles upon a piece of music that they know goes great with the themes coming up 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 months in advance, and you know that would be something that many people be interested in, you can contact me, well, through Sarah, probably, but you could contact me and we could mobilize all of the Soul Matters congregations to see who wanted to jump in on that, if that ever came up.
And a variant would be, we do have the themed music database at the AUUMM website. And so you can scroll through that for things that you are interested in. And if you see who submitted it or put a notice out on the social link for AUUMM, people are very willing to loan music. So if you have no money but can pay for shipping, a lot of congregations, because we don't use our entire library every year, and there's hundreds of pieces that I have that I'd be willing to loan out, but I it's not in my budget to cover shipping, but if you could cover a few bucks, 10 to 15 bucks to pay for shipping back and forth, there would be no problem with that. And I think using your colleagues in that way is a great benefit of networking with both Soul Matters and AUUMM. Other thoughts? Shauna.
Yes. Hi. My congregation, where I'm lucky to have eight people on uh, eight eight members of my choir all there at the same day for the monthly choir anthem. We've had good success with Jason Shelton's Cycle of Song. I think we've done three or four of them since I took a workshop where he introduced all eight pieces. But other than that, for the entire 2+ years where I've been where developing and choir directing has come into the music directing position. As an arranger and composer myself, pretty much everything that I've done, I've either arranged myself or found public domain things. Sometimes when I've been looking for things like once at springtime, I wanted to do like a madrigal type thing. I was able to find Now Is the Month of May. So I'm an expert at free because our congregation, other than buying the rights to Cycle of Song, has spent actually no money whatsoever.
Fantastic. Where do you go for your public domain music?
I Google things that I know I've heard, like in the case of the madrigal, it was one that I had heard before, so I just went and looked for it. IMSLP, I think it is.
Yep.
Is a great resource for public domain classical music. Also interested in other things that I've learned at workshops, and you know, in some of those cases, I'm just teaching them to my congregation by ear.
And I will add the Choral Public Domain Library, cpdl.org. An excellent resource, has probably more choral music on it than IMSLP. And it's historical music, all in public domain. But if you have a choir and a congregation that accepts that music, then it's a great place to get music for free. All you have to do is pay for the printing.
Thank you. I will look for that. Say the name again one more time, please.
cpdl.org, Choral okay. Public Domain Library.
Okay, thank you.
And before we leave this topic, I would want to remind people that books are a great place to get bang for your buck. We've already talked about Jason Shelton's collection. In the Soul Matters call a couple of months ago, the Anthems for Interfaith and Community Choirs from Amadon Music came up, and a lot of people said that they're using it. I'm currently not, but I am definitely going to be getting a perusal copy to see if it's something for our congregation. Mark, you had another question or comment?
Another offer. So Lawrence Cole has a website with some wonderful music, really designed for community singing and teaching orally, but he's got 30 or 40 songs there that are wonderful, that includes recording tracks, and for most of them it includes the digital music. He just asked for donations, but there's no fee, and I strongly recommend, just for your personal edification, if nothing else, go listen to Lawrence Cole music. It's wonderful. And you may find things that you want to use in your choirs.
Thank you. Sarah Jo.
There are a couple other compilations or anthologies, books I wanted to throw out there. We use Jim Scott's Earth and Spirit Songbook. Sometimes the notes don't line up quite as nicely as I'd like them to, but it works. The songs work really well, especially for small choirs, because it's unison for much of it. And then I just say, okay, make up a harmony if you're comfortable making up a harmony. And a lot of them can be put together really quickly. We did one for pickup choir this morning, and it took 10 minutes and we were ready to go. It was great. Also, the Justice Choir songbook is downloadable, and they ask for a donation. And that's just Justice Choir. If you Google that, and I haven't started using it, but I have a couple songs that are on my list for the next few months. And then the last one only has text, but it's from the Moral Mondays with Yara Allen and Dr. William Barber. And I will look up what that's actually called because it's not coming to me right now. But I will look that up and I will put it in the notes in the next couple of minutes.
In the chat box, right, Sarah Jo?
Yeah, in the chat box. That's what I mean. Sorry. I do think we need to probably move on to the next question. And if there are any ideas that trail in, feel free to use the chat box. The second topic that we thought is, how do you get instruments? And what kind of instruments?
So in this case, I don't think we're talking about large instruments like pianos. I think we're talking about additional instruments for praise bands or for playing along with hymns, for soloists. In our congregation, we've got a couple of crates full of toys, rhythm sticks, tambourines, rain sticks, things like that. So does anybody use those kinds of things as a supplement to their worship? Okay, so Sarah Jo, you were the only one who raised your hand. Can you give us some ideas how you got, how you built your collection and what it is that you use?
So we have a variety of things that we use. Someone handed me a box of kids' instruments one day and said, here. And I said, oh, great, thanks. And some of them are actually really good. We have some egg shakers that are pretty easy and some tambourines. And also we have 3 rain sticks that appeared out of nowhere, along with a whole bunch of rain sticks made out of very thick cardboard tubes, like shipping cardboard tubes. I believe somebody got them donated from their office or went to the mailroom at their office and just kind of took them when stuff came in. And the kids actually pounded nails through them and put beans in them and taped up the ends. I believe it's that formal that it's just masking tape or something on the end. And it works surprisingly well. And the kids really like them. And I will, so during a hymn that I think we could maybe use rain sticks, maybe there's a part about rain or we just want some extra noise, or I know that the kids have been up in a really boring service. I'm really sorry when that happens. And so we try and find something to get them moving at the end. And I say, if you feel moved to come up and get a rain stick, please do. And they love it.
We had a service last year where we wanted shakers for the kids. It may have been Easter, it may have been Music Sunday, I can't remember. But I went online looking for shakers because we only had less than 30. And I went to Amazon and I went to several other music distributors and I was really appalled at the price. But then I scrolled through several pages of various shakers on Amazon and I got them for like 50 cents each for a bag of 60 egg shakers. So it pays to have some patience with the process and spend a little bit of time, because the first thing they're going to try and sell you is a $25 single shaker, and nobody's got money for that. Other thoughts?
I don't know if it'd work in every situation, but one small congregation that I served, we had a public school music teacher, and she was able to coordinate with her, you know, principal and get permission, but they have piles of stuff that sit there on weekends. And so being able to tap into those relationships might be one small little strategy. Even if they don't go to your church, yeah. You know, small communities, that's one way to help.
Mark?
One thing we do is, rather than having the church own instruments, is we've done surveys of members to see who plays instruments and has their own instrument and wants to participate by playing with us. So it's not necessarily that the church purchases instrumentation. You find out who in the fellowship owns instruments and is willing to play.
And that way the church doesn't have to maintain the instruments either.
True.
As a small congregation, we've got just 55 members and no music budget. We have 3 members, one who plays our piano at the church, and a cellist and a guitarist who have come and done music for us. That's most of our music program at this point. And we're really blessed to have those three musicians among our 55 congregants.
And
do you ever give the cellist bassoon parts?
Bassoon parts? Mm-hmm. I don't think we've even approached bassoon parts.
I lived with a cellist for a long time. And we'd go to the library and we would find flute, oboe, or violin, and cello or bassoon, I think, were the two parts that she did well with. And we just play whatever. And actually, some libraries do have sheet music collections.
Mm-hmm.
It's worth checking out.
And I would just quickly add that I've served churches of all sizes, from 20 members up to 1,200. And figuring out the musical talent within, systematic ways to figure out the musical talent in musicians and music pieces, instruments, has always been a challenge. So a couple strategies I just lift up that I thought worked particularly well. In one of the congregations I served, we actually wove that into the new member joining process. So every time a new member joined, there was a gifts, we had it as a wider thing, we had our membership committee have a gift survey for every new member. And among those was, what music instruments do you play? Are you willing to play? So that's one way to collect it and put it in your database. Another piece was, we actually had a Sunday where we talked about gifts. And that was so we just send out the same survey to everybody, literally passed it around, had people put it in an offering plate. So a gifts Sunday. And you can imagine you can do that in a number of ways to collect that. And then another sneaky way was, in the summer, we would have our summer services outside. And then we would always make sure and do a summer musical jam outside, even though, because the service was outside, the picnic was outside. And all of a sudden, when you do sort of an open mic or a jam, you realize, oh my God, LB actually plays the ukulele? Write that down. So three strategies just to know what gifts are in your congregation.
Yeah, along those same lines, I always invite people to play along on the hymns. We have a pickup group that started off as Choir for All, but has morphed into Music for All, to make sure that I get players to come in and I discover new players and new instruments that way. And we, on the hymn sings that we have, we do twice a year, just potluck and hymn sing. And I invite people to bring their instruments to those as well. So that's another way of having people contribute that may be a little too shy to do it as a regular part of service, and getting at what they have in their personal inventory. Sarah Jo.
LB, when you invite people to come in to pick up music ensemble, how do you prepare parts? Do they have to sign up in advance, or do you just kind of?
I try and have C parts available, and then if I've got time to prepare them, B flat parts. And if they've, if they bring a heckle phone in and I don't have the right position for it, we'll give them shakers or percussion equipment.
It's like you've been in my congregation.
Okay. And the heckle phone is one of my favorites, but it is hard to provide parts for. Janice. Janice, you need to unmute first. So click on that same icon. There you go.
All right. I was listening to the discussion. I wanted to say that I found that it helps to encourage many different kinds of music. A lot of congregations get very hung up in traditional music, folk music, acoustic music. When we started our band at the UU Church in West Lafayette, Indiana, and we brought electric music into the church, there was a variety of opinions on that, and we persisted and gradually became a big part of the music scene in the congregation. which also features acoustic groups and things like that. But just to be open to different kinds of music rather than what you standard expect to find in a church.
Great. We had someone donate a large guitar amp to the church, which we keep handy so that anyone with electric instruments can plug into it. They don't have to think, oh, if I'd like to play at church, but I've got to bring an amp, it's such a pain. So this way they can, all they have to do is bring their instrument. And we even have cords. We've got the quarter inch plug. So we can hook up just about anything at this point. And that was a donation. That was nothing that we ever had to pay any money for. Shana.
So I do a lot of pickup bands or have pickup musicians that join at a very, I sometimes don't know they're coming to join that day until I'm there and they get there, but I provide, I have a little email list that I've created of all the possible musicians or singers. And I just put out there on Thursdays, once the order of service is finalized, here's what I'm doing. And if I have a link that I can send to somebody for a lead sheet, or I have it in my own files, I just include it in this as a PDF. So usually just lead sheets and chord sheets is it for a lot of what I do. So there's not a lot of part reading, but a number of the people I have are not part readers anyway, so.
Great. I also do frequent email communication to all the musicians in the church, letting them know of opportunities and keeping them informed of what's going on both in and nearby the church so that we can keep them as involved as possible, that it's a real music ministry and not just who's going to work for me for the service. But that's a little off topic. How are we doing on time?
We have a couple more minutes.
Okay, so we are still talking about how to get cheap instruments or free instruments, and Fred has something he wants to say. As soon as he figures out how to unmute in the lower left-hand corner of your screen, that little microphone icon, just click on it, and it should say unmute.
And Fred, I'm trying to unmute for you, but I'm not being successful here.
Let's see.
Why don't we move on? Fred, it looks...
Oh, he just got it.
I got it, yeah. This isn't quite on subject, but we're such a small congregation that it's difficult to get enough voices, like four, of each voice together on a given Sunday to sing. And it's even more difficult to get them together to rehearse. I don't drive after dark, and that's another problem. Here's my question. What I would like to be able to do, I'm pretty good with the software composition, composing program Finale. And I would like to be able to input a piece of music and send it to them along with a playable their part, and I'm wondering, is that legal?
Legality is a very fraught issue. On one side of it, you will hear that is publishing and does not qualify for any kind of church exemption. The other side would maybe be a little wishy-washy on it. I'm not a lawyer. I will say that if it's something that's I purchased and put in and have legal copies for, and I don't do it often, maybe. But if it's a regular practice, I would find difficulty with that myself.
Yeah, I understand. I don't have any problem with paying for enough copies, but it's the process that I almost need in order to be able to proceed.
There is something that we refer to as preservation of originals, and that's come up under question as to whether that actually exists. But most of the groups that I sing professionally with send out digital copies of the music and have originals on file. Again, I'm not the one doing it, so I can't speak to how well researched the legality of that is. I would not feel comfortable speaking anymore to this particular.
I understand. Thank you.
But let me just say, Fred, I think this is something, part of the power of these calls and the fact that Soul Matters and the Musicians Ministry group is doing is we can talk afterwards and try to follow up on that. You know what I mean? We may not have the answer tonight, but we'll right. put that question in and see what we can do with it. And I've just logged it down.
Thank you.
One of the things I do for my choir, and this won't get them the individual parts, but I have I've made a YouTube channel, and I link YouTube recordings to that channel, and then I send them out the link all the time because they don't actually bookmark it, which would be really wonderful if they'd bookmark it. But it's really easy to do if you create your own YouTube account. You can make a playlist, and I'll do that with anything I can find, to be quite honest. And it helps for the people who can't make my weekday evening rehearsals. It helps for people who need more time to learn a piece, and it helps for people who just want to listen to it more often. So that might be one thing that you could do that would be totally legal.
Yes, because any question of publication or reproduction is on the heads of the people who actually made the YouTube videos. We bear no liability in forwarding the link.
Yeah, it's not even forwarding. It's not, the link being forwarded is to my playlist, but I'm not making another copy of it. I'm just kind of like filing it in a way it can be easily found is what I'm doing. I'm making a connection.
Mark?
So I have a question that you probably can't answer here, but it's around legality of using these YouTube videos. We have a projector and screen and sometimes play a YouTube video as part of our service. So if anybody has any clue as to what to watch for there.
Sarah Jo.
This is what I know. Using copyrighted video in service is not legal without permission. On YouTube, there is often a way to contact the person who made the video. They may or may not respond. And I'm not sure about 100%, but I believe that if it's created under Creative Commons, there's a CC mark at the, I don't know where it is, and it's somewhere on YouTube, at the bottom of the video or in the, you know, the name, date, serial number portion of it. And that CC means that it is usable and you can distribute it and you can project it.
Also, there are licensing organizations. We belong to a video licensing, and I don't have the information because I didn't realize it was going to be brought up on this call. It costs us, I believe, $900 a year, and that covers both in-service and out-of-service for certain copyrighted materials, as far as playing them during the service, immediately before, immediately after, or in church-related things, as long as it is here in our church building. We cannot broadcast it. We can't use the license for a church meeting outside of the sanctuary. But when it's here, it's okay.
I did not know about those. We should probably get back to the questions, right?
Yeah.
One thing I wanted to add to the instrument discussion is when you have instrumentalists, think of creative ways to use them. Right, that cello player, that David had been talking about, use it as a baseline. Mm-hmm. Why not? I mean, a cello player, if they're good, they might actually have fun laying down a really good baseline on something because it's not something they do all the time. They're like, oh, I get to play a different part. This is cool. Or I do that. I have an accordion player, and often she's not very good. She can play simple things very well. And so oftentimes I actually use her as a bass function. And it works better than you would expect. So we've done bass, mandolin, and flute, and it's been a really good ensemble because we have the melody, we have the chords, and we have a bass line. So think of creative ways. You know, just because an instrument is normally used in X way doesn't mean it can't be used in Y and Z or 37 or something.
And I will just add that I know on Thursday we're going to have at least one and probably several people who are involved in very successful instrumental programs. So there will be more information presented on this topic on Thursday. So if you can't tune into the call on Thursday, then you'll probably want to go back and play that that version of it so mm-hmm. that you get all of the information that's presented over the two sessions.
We should go on to the next topic, which is really how do you find musicians, right? And how do you find the regular musician who shows up and plays the hymns, and how do you find special people who come in? And we touched on it a little bit, but what other thoughts? You know, probably some other thoughts out there.
And specifically, how do we get them for as little as possible and still be ethical about it? Lisa?
Yeah, I had a question about that because I live in a town that has a university. And so we thought, oh, it'd be nice to have university students come in. We'd pay them, but it's also experience for them to do like maybe one song in the service. But I don't know how to go about recruiting them. And I wondered if anybody had any advice on that or finding them.
I can speak to that a little bit. Most universities, most sizable universities will have a student performance office. And if you go through that, you'll find that they are asking for $250 to $400 per musician per gig. That's not practical for us. However, if you go to the individual studios, if you contact, I've just gone onto the website. We're right adjacent to Michigan State University, which is a large university with a thriving music program. We also have Lansing Community College. So go onto the website, look in the directory. It should say who is teaching what, and then contact them through email or phone calls and say, do you have such and such a player? That's how we get our pianists. We're fortunate enough to be able to pay our staff pianist, and they have all been graduate students from the university. Our women's chorus director is also a student at the university who is working as an intern for us. So despite the fact that we don't encourage people to work for not getting money. This is one of the things that I'm working towards in the long term for us is to get her paid. It is a learning experience, and we have had no shortage of people applying for it, knowing that all they get is experience. Are there other thoughts on this, Scott?
Well, LB, it was just a question. I know my daughter, every year, she's in high school, she's not college, but she plays a guitar, and every year her teacher says she has to do some public performance as just part of their just normal teaching. Do anybody have any experience with that? Because that, again, not to exploit folks, but those are high school kids, not college, not at professional level, but some pretty advanced who are looking for those performance experiences.
I do not, but that's fantastic of the teacher to do, and it's a good thing to know. And I may call one of the local music schools and see if any of the teachers do that, because there are never enough musicians. You'll find on a particular service that even though you've got 20 guitarists in your congregation, not a single one of them is available for a specific day that you really want a guitar.
One thing that's been helpful for us is we're a lay-led congregation, so we don't have a minister in the pulpit every Sunday. We will several times a year have a musical service where we have musicians come in, give the service, we give them our regular guest speaker fee, and then have a concert either Sunday afternoon, Sunday evening, or maybe even Saturday night, where they get to use the space. You know, we either give the space gratis or there's a small space use fee, but they have the opportunity to then present a concert and make it more worth their while to show up, more worth their while to do the whole gig.
Well, that's a great idea. I just want to make sure I heard you right there, David. So you sort of did an exchange, right? You said, because tons of people need space, you traded space also for a gig that they would do in your worship.
Well, traded space, or they get to use the space for a nominal fee for a concert, and we help promote the concert.
Wow.
Yeah, we've done the same thing with graduate students doing their graduate recitals and saying, sure, we'll give this to you at a reduced price. All you have to do is play a couple of pieces on a service for us. Lisa, you had a thought or comment?
Well, just that we've done something similar with our town's women's chorus. We allow them to rehearse in our building, and we don't charge them, but they do a service for us every year.
When I had a semi-pro group in Detroit, that we had a similar arrangement. We were able to rehearse for free at a time that the sanctuary was never being used. And once a month, I'd provide a soloist from the group to provide music, because we didn't have, our choir only performed once a month. So we were always looking for special music. And this was a great way to spread that out and give people a chance to perform who might not otherwise have it. Other thoughts on getting musicians into your space for little to no money or creative exchanges? Sarah Jo?
We have a pianist in the congregation who will occasionally sub for me. And I've paid her sometimes, but quite often she's willing to just take it as her part of her her donation. And so she takes it as a tax write-off. And that's her choice. You know, I just offer it. How do you want money, or do you want the tax write-off? And it doesn't matter to us, but it works well.
So you worked that out with your church finance people to be able to give her a receipt or for services rendered? Great.
Yep. When I turn it in just like I would a normal check, but I write down that it's for taxes only.
Janice, was that a hand? Okay. We have several groups here. A lot of our people overlap, but we give them the opportunity to play the kind of music that they like to play, and then we ask them to do it in service a couple of times a semester. So our folk musicians really like old-timey country bluegrass, and we give them a chance to do that in service, as well as just getting together and doing it for fun. We have a jazz combo that does the same kind of thing. So it's expanding the music ministry side of it, but it also works for bringing music into worship. Mark, is that a question?
I think it is, but I'm just really curious as to the tax paperwork and consequences of accepting donated time and service and getting a receipt for it. So if you have any sort of standards of how this works for tax purposes, that's an interesting thought. So does she get a deduction or?
Yeah, I think she can report it. And if you're deducting, she's been able to report it on her taxes as a church donation. It's not anything I'm doing. I'm the go-between, so I don't know really how it functions, and I try and stay as far away from money and numbers as I can.
Yes, this is probably not the right group to ask the question, but...
Never hurts to ask.
Sarah Jo, maybe you can find that information out before Thursday's call.
Maybe.
So if the same subject comes up, we can address it or put it into the notes somehow.
Yeah, if our bookkeeper's around on Tuesday, usually she is.
Yeah, I have a pianist who serves as my principal substitute pianist. So when she plays the whole service, she gets paid. But she also often sits in with the jazz band. And when she does that, she's working just as a volunteer. It's a little tricky, but basically she's doing the volunteer stuff with the jazz band. And then she's agreeing to play some of the rest of the service for free because it's their church.
One other thing I've done kind of unintentionally is occasionally a kid will come up to me after service and say, I've been studying piano for 3 years. And I'll look at him and go, great, you should bring me a piece and we'll listen to it and see what it sounds like. And maybe we can use you in a service. And I've had some kids take me up on it. And I'm not saying you should go out and ask all the kids to do this, but what it's done is then other adults are like, whoa, wait, that kid's in third grade and just played Twinkle Twinkle Little Star or whatever it was. It doesn't even matter if you can find an appropriate little interlude spot for it. Like, wait, I could play. And so it's really opened up the volunteer group of adults, because suddenly they realize it's not that big of a deal.
Yeah, I think too, working with the high school students who are fairly adept and whose information we wouldn't have in the membership rules. And that's something I'm trying to get better at. I've been surprised by the high schoolers when they say, for our high school service, can I play this? I'm like, well, of course you can. And why haven't I known about you before? Because I'd love to use you in a lot of services. And unlike the college students, even the ones who live nearby, they still have some time that they can contribute to the church and some interest in it. So it's a good area to dig for free musicians.
Sometimes if you have a teen advisor or a teen group or someone running religious education, communicating with them is good. Our youth are in our roles, and not everyone can see them, but staff can. And I know our religious educator pretty well, so I'll kind of nudge her and be like, "Hey, Tina, who's playing this year?" I think. Are there any more ideas for instrumentalists? Because we're getting towards the end of our time. I know Scott wanted to do one more thing before we wrap up.
Yeah, I think we should probably toss to Scott at this point.
Catch.
Okay, there we go. You guys, just thank you so much. I think when LB, Sergio, and I envisioned this, we knew that we didn't want to set, well, let me say, they knew that we didn't want to set up a structure where you just got talked at. I came in with an overly planned thing where you all sit passively and listen to four very smart, wise voices and then just leave. They said not to do that. And I'm glad that they were they won the day on that. So just thank you for everything everybody shared. On that note, like I said, we're going to be doing another repeat of this with the same questions, right? So what Sarah had said, how do you find music, instruments, and musicians? We're going to be doing that on Thursday. There's another dimension, right, we talked about. So Sarah began by saying, here's what we all have for budgets. It usually doesn't go far enough. So what are the strategies we use to make the money we have go further? A whole different discussion is, how do we increase the pot we have? So how do you, you know, fundraising strategies and techniques. So I would ask is, if you quickly right now know what questions you have around improving your fundraising or how to get more money or how to fundraise better, if you know particular questions about that you want to just put into the chat box right now, that'd be great. If not, I believe you should have had the email address of me at Soul Matters that you can send it to. So basically what we're doing is we're looking for your ideas. If we do a follow-up webinar in a month or two on fun, you know, how do you raise funds for music ministries? What are the questions you'd like us to address? So plunk those in the chat box now or email those to me afterwards. And on that same note, if you have ideas about, other collaborative conversations we could have around music that LB, Sarah Jo, and I just haven't maybe thought of. Like I said, how to get musicians, music, and instruments, then how to increase your pockets have been what we thought were the questions. But are we missing one? Is there a question that would be helpful for us to pull voices together to chat about? Also let us know. We have, Well, we're out of time. So I was going to open it up, but if we do, I think we'll end up talking for 5 minutes. So let me call that a day. Can we be, since we are a religious group and a network of congregations, LB and Sarah, can I put you on the spot just to lift up, based on, you know, a gift that you would like to say that you found because of tonight's conversation, just a statement of gratitude as we go.
So I just wanted to say thanks for all the good ideas you all brought. I'm sure some of you walked in here thinking, I don't really have anything to offer. I'm just going to listen. But I found that most of the time in these webinars, everyone who walks in adds something and everyone walks away with something. So I just thank you for your conversation.
And I would like to thank you all for joining in. I'm not sure I've been on a webinar with any of you other than Scott and Sarah Jo, or have met at one of the conferences. So it's always great to meet new colleagues, and I hope that we have much more interaction going forth.
Great, and always remember, besides these webinars, if you're a Soul Matters congregation, you're welcome to join the monthly music brainstorming call that Sarah Jo hosts on the, which day of the month, Sarah?
Thursday, the second or third. We just had it this past Thursday.
I think it's the second Thursday.
Yeah, at 1 o'clock Eastern time.
The second Thursday of each month. Please join us if you're professional, lay, music major, anything. We brainstorm for music for 2 or 3 months ahead of our themes that we're working on. So, with that, thanks for the gifts. I secretly hope we see at least 2 or 3 of you on Thursday's call as well. There's no shame in double dipping. We'll talk to you soon. Take care, friends.